Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Would you please welcome onto the stage Mr. Tommy Tiernan?
Thank you very much, thank you. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, you're all very welcome to the show. I guess what's going to happen here over the next hour or so, it cannot be used in the real world. There are no rules. We're not concerned with political correctness. We're not concerned with not offending anybody. We will try and offend. Please get in line. We will try and offend as many people as we possibly can. The things that are going to be said here cannot be taken and used in the real world. It's like when you're having sex with your girlfriend, and as part of the process to liven the whole thing up for the pair of you, you roar out, "Go on, you big fucking who are you?" She is not allowed. She is not allowed. Come up to you the next day and go, "What did you call me last night?" I like of you to think of this gig as the opposite of mass. Somewhere we can come in the darkness and just fucking let go for a little while. I am concerned with what's funny, and sometimes it's not what is funny is not clever. Sometimes what is funny is crude, and it's fucking cock and cunt and balls. But it's funny. It is fucking funny. Whatever fucking happens, happens. I find it hard, you know, to write comedy. I'm not a writer. I'm a fucking thinker. A thinker and a talker. I've sat at computers. I've tried to write fucking jokes. Looking at the keyboard thinking, how many fucking versions of QWERTY can there be? It doesn't suit me. Poetry doesn't fucking suit me. A novelist will just bang it out. Okay? A novelist will just sit at his fucking typewriter and he'd be fucking going like this fucking... You know, just banging his fucking hands like that. Until it is accomplished. A poet is different. A poet is, the less words, the better. A poet has to fucking wait. And wait. And if he knows if he used the wrong word, the whole poem is fucked. He has to have the patience of a fucking priest in a hedge. Just fucking waiting. I'm waiting! And if he knows, if he fucking leaps too soon, it's over. I will arise now and go to Headford. No, fuck! Have to try it again tomorrow. I know that all our lives are just normal and ordinary, and we feel for others and we meet them, and it's all very sincere. And there's also an element of my brain which kind of is looking for the funny side of it. Irrespective of how sincere or how badly off the other person might be, it doesn't matter what they've been through. There's a part of my brain which is always looking for the funny side in every situation. And it nothing to do with political correctness. Just whatever is fucking funny. I was driving in my car the other day and my mobile rang and I answered it. And I started thinking to myself, what would be the funniest thing? Irrespective of the horror of reality, what would be the funniest fucking thing that could happen now? And for me, it was that if I had a CD in the car, ready to go, an audio track of me in a fucking crash. So your mobile rings and you go, "Oh, how are you, Ken? How's it going? Hang on there for a second." Can you imagine him? And when it's all over, he's like, "Tommy?" You know, fuck it, I'll text him later about... Tried calling you, couldn't get through there. a year round at all. So I would do a lot of work for Down Syndrome Ireland. And when I did this motorcycle ride around the country, and every single town we went to, the Down Syndrome kids came out and they sat on the bikes, and it was brilliant. And I loved being with them, because there's something fucking mental about Down Syndrome children. They're kind of, they have a wonderful kind of energetic eccentricity about them. They're not self-conscious in the same way we are. They kind of go, are you Mickey Joe Hart? Are you Mickey Joe Hart? Are you Mickey Joe Hart? Who are you? You're a fucking asshole. Right, so, I have a lot of excess energy, and it's hard for me to know what to do with it all the time, you know? So at the moment, I'm training for the marathon. I'm training for it because Down Syndrome Ireland asked me to do it. I think that's what they fucking said anyway. It's hard. Do you know what I mean? I'd feel a bit fucking stupid if it wasn't, to be honest with you, you know? They only sent me out for a bar of chocolate, you know? I come back 6 months later, where the fuck were you? Big month ago, I sent you for a bar of chocolate. I even specified the type of chocolate that I wanted. Is it a Snickers or a marathon? Can you come back here? Silver layer with nothing. You fucking asshole. So yeah, you know, and it's all meant in devilment. You know what I mean? There's no. I don't drink, you know, and the reason I don't drink is because I don't believe that drinking and civilization go together, and I believe that the fault is with civilization. You have people nowadays being arrested for being drunk and disorderly. What other kind of a fucking state are you supposed to be in when you're drunk? People!
Wow.
People should be arrested for being drunk and mannerly. Yeah. Are you going to take this drinking shit seriously or not? Could you fuck off and break a few windows for yourself then? Don't be paining me whole. So, in order to get my kicks now, instead of drinking, what I like to do is I like to fuck with my karma. What I mean by that is I like to try stuff that isn't illegal. Right? But something in me is going, Tommy. So the vibe I'm on at the moment is parking in handicapped spaces. Right? It gives me a little fucking, whoa, you fucker, you mad bastard. It's great, it's not wrong, it's just, you know, fuck it, handicapped people can't be downtown all the time. You know? And tell me, why are handicapped spaces so close to the fucking shops? Huh? It's not like they've got far to walk, is it? Is it? I think handicapped spaces should be, I think they should be on a little fucking ramp, like a skateboard joke. Right? Far away from the shops, you open the van and just hooch the fuckers out. They gave a murder ball. It'd be brilliant for them. Anyway, you have, when you're coming back to your car and somebody is taking your registration plate, you know, for parking in a handicapped zone, you have a few options. Okay? Your first option is to make noise before they see you. All right? All of a sudden to start shouting, it's a miracle! It's a miracle! Da 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 da! 3 Diet Cokes! Who would have thunk it? Unbelievable! Second option, which is the Irish option, right? Which is to apologise and retreat, isn't it? Oh my God, I'm so sorry. Oh, I'm sorry, was I part? Oh, I'm such a spa! Or am I? Third option, which is my favourite option, which is to attack. Seize the moral high ground if possible. I say to the lady, what are you doing? She says, I'm taking your registration number. Why?
because you're parked in a handicapped zone and you're not handicapped. I roar out, fucking look again. This is where she panics now. She's fucking checking you up and down. She doesn't want to have missed anything, you know. That would have just upset her totally. So she can see that you're not obviously disabled. Now she must check to see if you're not bizarrely disabled. Some weird thing that would still entitle you to a disc, like if your head had two faces. And I say to her, I say, surely an inability to be content and form long-lasting loving relationships is as much of a fucking handicap as having wonky legs. Just because I don't have big arse wheels doesn't mean I'm not disabled. Where are my Olympics? Yes, selfish fucker. The reason I'm running for the marathon is because I've got all this fucking excess energy, do you know what I mean? When you don't drink, it has to fucking go somewhere, do you know what I mean? And I used to run everywhere as a child. I had too much fucking energy, you know. I'd just run here, and I'd just run there, and I'd run down to the shops, and forget what it was I was supposed to get. And I'd run back, and Mammy Bear, two loaves of bread and a pint of milk, and I'd fucking run back down to the shop, and I would be looking at Mrs. Egan, and I'd be going, I haven't a clue what I'm supposed to get. Just lift up shit, I might be reminded. And now, as an adult man, it's important to run. You know, women are so much more attractive in the summertime and they're unveiling themselves inch by inch. And it's hard for men to fucking know how to deal with that. You know, so I have to run. Run the horn off myself. Run and run and run till absolutely no blood can go to my bollocks. Even if I came across six naked women going, fuck me, fuck me, fuck me, I'd be there, get out of the way! Marathons, as you all know, were started thousands of years ago in ancient Greece when there was a big, huge battle between the forces of Sparta and the forces of Centra. And there was a big... for real. And Centra were fighting for the way we live today. So the battle finished and they had to tell their friends in Marathon of the victory. So they couldn't get any coverage where they were, so they said, you have to run. This is way before cool gear now, right? This was sandals and fucking iron vests. This was back in the day when Nike and Adidas were people. There was Nike and his brother Pikey. Pikey had the slash hook the other way around. So, according to the story, what happened was that the guy, he ran the 26.2 miles, he delivered the message and then he died. You know? And I was thinking, well, there's no way that he could have delivered the proper message. Like, if your body is a total death shutdown, right, there's no way your mind can be focused entirely on what you're saying. So he ran the 26.2 miles, and the other guys are there, friend, what message you bring us from Sparta? And he's there, oh, he's there, two loaves of milk and a pint of bread. Six naked women back there. I don't like clocks. I just don't fucking like them, you know. I prefer to live on this thing called farmer time, where you get up in the morning and there's stuff to be done, rather than being hounded by a fucking device all day. Tick, 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 tick. Fuck off! A clock to my life is like a hen to a naked man, sunburnt and covered in fucking corn. It's just... It's an unnecessary fucking hassle. I like the idea of farmer time. Farmer time is a lot more kind of gentle. First of all, a farmer's waking up by the coolest motherfucker on the farm. The cockerel, right? Cockerel is this fucking jazz bird, he big fucking head in him. He's up all night and everyone's asleep and he's fucking standing up on the beam and he's there. What the fuck, everybody? Yeah, everybody get up. What the fuck? Yeah, come on. I fucking hate cornflakes. I don't know. Come on, the fuck. That's right. Come on, the fuck. Everybody get up. That's right. Keep your fucking real.
Over to the hens.
How are you, girls? All right. Give it a go. Everybody up the fuck. That's what I'm saying now. That's what I'm fucking saying now. Up the fuck. Fucking noon walking on the beam. Here we go. Everybody up the fuck.
And a farmer gently rises up. And he doesn't think what time it is. He thinks, what do I have to do today? Oh, yeah. I'd get a bit of baling twine for the gate. And he does that. What'll I do now? I better bring the cows in. The cows are never there in the field going, what fucking time do you call this? So it's an older kind of, slightly more agricultural, and I like that. I like the farm. But they're trying to remove the farm from our lives now. Even in stuff as obvious as fucking sex. They're trying to take the agriculture out of sex and put it into a fucking chemical laboratory. And that's not where it belongs. They've invented this new male pill now, a male contraceptive pill. You know what the women are thinking? There's no fucking way you trust a man to take that every day of the week. And you'd be right, we wouldn't. We'd take five of them on a Friday. And just fucking hope for the best. This new male pill, what it does is, it gives the man all the sensation of ejaculation, but nothing comes out, right? So it's like your cock burps, right? Oh my God, I'm so sorry. If you're cocking little hands. Oh my God, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. Oh, mother of God. What did I have for dinner? Jesus. So the guy over there, you know, I'm gonna come. And I don't. Why do we tell our women that? It's like we're fucking 3 years of age and we're telling our mothers, I'm gonna do a poo. I gotta do a poo. 20 years later, I'm gonna come. So nothing comes out. Fucking nothing. And I don't know how women feel about sperm. Sperm is something that women have to deal with more now than they did 20 years ago. When I was growing up, a blowjob was something you had to go to America to get. If you gave a man in Ireland in the 70s a blowjob, his fucking dog would burst into flames. It just... be like splitting the fucking atom. What are you at? Outside tit was as wild as it got when we were kids. Down a country lane beside the river, feeling a human breast through 8 layers of Mercy Convent uniform. And even still afterwards, she'd be, am I pregnant? Just tell me, am I pregnant? You have to show her the glove. I told you I'd mind you. I fucking told you. Can I come in your tits? And the whole sperm thing, that's one of the things that I could never be gay. I can look at blokes and say they're good looking. I can imagine maybe after a few pints kissing a bloke. But I could never, and me and another bloke fucking coming all over each other. It's just, I would find the abundance of spunk fucking revolting. I'd rather have the scutters with another fucking bloke. And get fucking demon seed in me eye. So sperm is something that women have to deal with a lot more nowadays, and I know, because women are so caring. Women are better at loving than men are.
You're just better. Do you know what I mean? Like with Down syndrome people. Down syndrome people, they're a lot more loving, aren't they? They just have that fucking affection thing. And women are a bit like that as well. They have that kind of... You'd never say it to them, though, you're such a spa, you know, but then... Let's call it up syndrome, okay, just to make you feel good about yourself, right? So I know that when a guy comes in your mouth, women are very thoughtful creatures, a guy comes in your mouth, right, and you're the one fucking wondering, like, you have a decision to make, a pretty fucking quick one, too, I think... You're not going to be phoning your sister on this one, are you? I don't worry.
No, I don't want to talk to Mammy.
And women are so caring that they think, okay, should I spit it out or should I swallow it? It's a big thing. He's looking at me, watching me. I don't want to hurt his feelings, but I don't want to think that I want him forever. What am I going to fucking do? I'm here, girls. I'm here to remove that pressure from you and to tell you that girls, as men, we don't give a fuck what you do with it. Just get it out of the fucking room. And brush your teeth before you come back as well. I know that Irish women have a lot of complaints when it comes to the style of lovemaking that they get from us Irish blokes. Irish women are always wanting their Irish men to slow down. Will you slow down? For fuck's sake, Paddy, will you slow down? You're not robbing a shop. Will you fucking relax? The shop is open. 24 hours just for you. They can take whatever you want. Just slow the fuck down. Take it easy. Hold me, Paddy. Hold me. Give us a hug and a cuddle. Come on, for fuck's sake, Paddy. Mind me, I'm your China girl. Mind me, Paddy. Mind me, take it easy. Wash me hair, Paddy. Just slow down to fuck. And that's what you want, girls. You're entitled to it. And that's what you want. You should fucking sleep with each other. You can take all the fucking time you want then. Stopping every 20 minutes for a chat. How's it going for you? Where's it going around today? Because I think basically, as much as being ridden, that's what women want. Women want to be listened to. You know, see, all relationships go through the same phase. It's the first 3 weeks or whatever. It's sex and flattery, isn't it? And sexy clothes and stuff like that. So I'll be sexy clothes. And then comes the listening exam, right? Where the woman will talk for 18 or 19 months and you're supposed to fucking remember shit. She'll tell you everything she likes and doesn't like. I don't like dark chocolate. Oh, I'd love to open a jewellery shop and sell jewels. And it's not that as men that we don't find that fucking fascinating, but we just can't look at you and listen to you at the same time, right? It's like radios. You wouldn't be looking at the fucking radio all day to know that it's on. It just fills the house and you're fucking grand with that. Like, going for a slash. Yeah, I can hear you. And historically, that's the way it's supposed to be. Historically, the woman was inside in the cave and the man was on the lip looking out for fucking dragons and all types of weird jungle shit. And the way that the woman let him know that everything inside in the cave was okay was that if he could hear, my sister, And to this day, the most terrifying sound to a man is silence.
All right. And what did you say?
Well, I said I didn't want to. And men all over the world have to deal with this, not just fucking Irish men. Chinese men are there listening to their women. Eskimo women are yapping the same stuff. They go. Eskimos actually are one of my favourite people in the world because I think they're so kind of innocent and mysterious. You know, I think they're just away from everything. Eskimos have never done any fucking damage to the world. People know fuck all about them. We don't even know the name of their country. They've never entered the World Cup. They're just, nobody knows what an Eskimo looks like without his fucking jacket on. They're just these mystery people. Don't be recording the show. What are you doing? How much? The lady here, not even looking at me through her phone. I'm fucking here. How much closer to you do I have to fucking get? To be in the same fucking room as you. Look. Look. Look at me. I'm here. Touch me. Fucking touch me! Put out your. I'll fucking touch you if you don't touch me. Now, stand up, stand up. Just fucking stand up. Stand up, look. Look. Look now.
I'm fucking listen.
Now. Answer me this. Could your fucking phone do this for you? Could it? Could it? Does there always have to be a gadget between you and other people? I think with global warming, that the next tide of immigration to this country is going to be fucking Eskimos. Other people around the world are getting slightly uncomfortable. Eskimos are genuinely fucked. Their country is, there's less of it every single day. If you don't want immigrants to come to this country, right, the first place you should send them when they arrive is Offaly. Because Offaly is a, I don't understand Offaly. I don't get it. I don't understand how people can fucking settle there. I can understand when this country was been colonized by human beings, right? I can understand how posh fuckers got off the boat and landed in fucking Dorky and went, well, if you think I'm walking one step further, you must be out of your tiny mind. I'm fucking exhausted after that. I can understand how people stopped on the edge of the Aran Islands going, is that the end of it? I'll fucking do it again. I won't. But I don't understand. I don't understand fuckers who stopped in Offaly. I don't understand what it is about that fucked fucking soul hole that would make somebody, did it do me now. An unending monotonous landscape. I love that, yeah. There's nothing there. It's the most depressing. You can do suicide for the leave insert in Offaly. It's just fucking depressing. I stayed in a bed and breakfast in Offaly once in Tullamore, the Atlantic Home Care View. Fella brought me up to the attic. See there? No, you can see the back of the Atlantic Home Care. That's some mess, isn't it? You want to see the front of the shop? Fuck off. Do you want your cake and eat it too, do you? They're the type of people who get up at 4 o'clock in the morning to watch massive diggers being transported across the country. And now, unbelievable. Jeff, never thought a human mind is capable of imagining a digger that size. And I've been all over the world, I've been everywhere. I've been to Ferbana, Mamelik. I've never seen a digger like that. Where are you going? You going to bed, Jamie? What? Me? Do you think I'm going to sleep after seeing that digger? Will I see you at the Lino Festival tomorrow? Lino from all over the country, huh? Unbelievable, unbelievable. Every signpost in Offaly just points to another fucking place in Offaly. There's no way of getting out. There's one on the border of Westmeath pointing towards Athlone. But instead of saying Athlone, it says, your loss. Once upon a time, I walked around Ireland, and no matter what way I plotted it out, I couldn't avoid going fucking through Offaly. I was even tempted to go to France and come up into Cork, but I had to. We went to this wedding in Tullamore, and we got dancing with the bride and the groom and stuff like that. One of those weird weddings where you think it's odd that the bride is more excited about dancing with somebody who's not from fucking Tullamore than she is with her husband, you know? She'd ZZ Top as her fucking wedding music. So we went to bed about 4 o'clock in the morning, and I got up at 9 to move on, you know, and the groom was still up, still fucking hammered. Yeah. Hey, Tommy, how are you? She's a bit rough, isn't she? Oh, she's no, don't, she's rough as fuck. Know what they say though, don't you? Head down, think of the sister. Lots of different people coming to the country now. It's fabulous. New injections of blood. We're only fucking new blood ourselves, really, when you think about it. And I think in terms of sex, it's a fantastic thing. Because it now means that women will get more than just the Irish experience. Women will be able to sleep with blokes from all over Poland. And it's going to be... It'll sound magical and mysterious to you, right? Because Irish man dirty talk, there's not much of a difference between an Irish bloke talking dirty to you and somebody encouraging a team of young hurlers. Keep the head down. On it. What are you doing in the ditch? Right? Now you're going to get me these swarthy blokes all rippled and muscled from building shit. They'll be standing there at the foot of the bed and you'll be lying down naked in your Celtic freckled majesty. With your hand over your mole because you don't know him that well yet. And the Polish bloke will be standing at the foot of the bed and you won't have a clue what he's saying, but it's just going to sound so fucking magnificent. He's going to be there. Head down, think of your sister. What you gonna do? You know, being But moving in the fucking, I'm such a, you know, moving in the circles that I'm moving now. You know, I've had sex with so many fucking celebrities now that's really... Mary McAleese would be the person that I have sex with. Mary McAleese is a fucking whore to go, so she... I swear to Jesus. You're getting invited up to Oris on Gutheron, we call it. You're told to wait in this special room. Then the soldiers come and get you. And they bring you in, right, and they fuck you into this place. And Mary's lying there in the nude on a big, huge bed, the shape of Ireland. Legs open at the Shannon. And she'll have the words of the national anthem written all the way across her body. And down here, Anoch the Haim to Barna Braille. Tonight at midnight in the gap of danger. And the soldiers will force you up the Shannon estuary. You'll have to keep going until you meet the president. You'll bump into her in Athlone, which we all know is a fucking hole of a town anyway. And I know that when... No, at least as human beings, we have the facility for boring sex. Right? At least we have that option. Other creatures don't. Ducks. Have you ever seen ducks make love? I've no idea what the rest of you do with your fucking time, to be honest with you. Right? But duck love is amongst the most vicious in the animal kingdom. And they look so fluffy and innocent, don't they? The lady duck, she's just fucking swimming around. No idea what's about to happen. Just having the quack. Just... The man duck is perched on this big black cloud of death. He comes a swooping down to her. She's vaguely aware of a kind of a darkening and the rustling of feathers and the rippling of water. Then the man duck, he just fucking grabs her by the neck, shoves her head into the water, and he rapes her! He rapes her! For darkness. You know what I mean? And it's the great about all the Eastern European people coming to the country because you can't fucking get them excited about anything. And that's what's brilliant. They remind us of ourselves maybe 60 or 70 years ago.
What do you want me to do? Very happy to be in Iowa. Yes, it's a great place. I want to work with children. I love their happy little faces. Little kiddies. Wah, 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 wah.
I think as a culture, we're caught between that and the American thing. And the American thing is where everybody is trying so fucking hard to appear to be happy that it drives them insane. Right? They spend all day trying to be fucking happy that their only way of relaxing when they go home at night is watching shows about murder. That's the only way they have of fucking unwinding. We're not like that. Glenrothes wasn't a murder in it for 25 fucking years. And when they did, it was mentioned in the fucking Doll, the t-shirt. What the fuck's going on in Glenrothes? America is just this, it's just, they're trying too hard as well. Have a nice day, 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 have a nice day. Sounds like a fucking threat to an Irish person. I'll have every kind of a fucking day I want to have. Why limit myself to fucking niceness? There's loads more shit out there. And Irish people, to one another, we're a lot more realistic than that, don't we? We know that those are things, the fucking perfect happy world. We know about the random cruelty of the universe. Irish people don't say, have a nice day. No, a lot more realistic. We say, good luck. Good luck to you. And all the religion in America, it's all suffused with this idiotic fucking reaching for fucking giddy idiocy. It's just, Jesus wants you to be happy. You're going to be happy. He wants you to be happy. Yes, they will be happy. Y'all want to be happy. Jesus wants you to be happy. Says so right here in the Bible. I want you to be happy. You're going to be happy. These preachers are fucking superstars in America. In Ireland, we think they were retarded. You're going to be happy. That's right, just get into the bus, will you? Your helmet has your name on it. Says spa, you can sit at the back. So we need the darkness. We can never let it go. Last year, it was 100 years since Samuel Beckett's birth, and the government wanted to do something. Can you imagine Samuel Beckett being celebrated in fucking Disneyland or in America? No, it wouldn't happen. It's us. So the government decided what they'd do is they would project sentences from his plays up onto buildings all over Dublin. You know, only country in the world that could handle that. People on their way to work on Monday morning and a big 40-foot high letters across the central bank, I can't go on. Might as well have said, go back to bed. We have such an interesting relationship, I think, with people who are trying to reach beyond themselves. You know, there's a, like someone like Bono, for example, right? This is an interesting question. Is Bono still one of us? Is he? We're not sure, are we? Like, he's not one of us the way Christy Moore is one of us. He's. Right? Like, you can't imagine Bono in the Kilkenny hurling dressing room at halftime going, fucking fair play to you, lads, just there. It'd be like seeing Marty Morrissey in a fucking Dr. Dre video. It's hotting up here. So, Doctor, how are things going for you this year? You were unlucky against Tyrone, but then that's the way it goes in the championship. Oh, you dirty bitch. Anyways, I've got... I never been with a black girl, Doctor. Will I give it a go? How are you? Look at fuck. Hey, you know Sean O'Gohalpine, do you? I thought all you fellas knew each other. So I wonder about Bono, you know, and that most other cultures revere Bono. They think he's a bit of a fucking idiot, but. But he's grand, and he's grand. And it must be changing your name in Ireland to have the fucking chutz to do that. Bono was about 15 or 16 when he changed his name. I was imagining what it was like in his house, you know. Like, and he came from a very fucking ordinary household. His older brother is called Norman, right? So, he would have been shit as the leader of U2, wouldn't he? My name is Norman. Keeping it real. Norman could have been the roadie for the fucking Botty band or Planxty or something, but not you too. So the dad comes home from work one day, and Bono's in the kitchen, and the dad says, the dad says, "How are you, Paul?" "That's not my name anymore! Paul is dead! Death to Paul! Paul is no more! My name is Bono! Bono Vox! I am Bono! Isaiah said, you shall be lifted up to the sky and then thrown back to the ground! I said, thrown back to the ground!" Where's Norman? Norman is out mowing the lawn, right? The doorbell rings. The Owl for the Ghost answers. Pulls it open. "How are you, Dave?" "Dad, you biggie! That's not Dave, Dad! That's not Dave! That's the age! The fucking age! That's the fucking age, man! He's living on the edge of fucking insanity and sincerity, Dad! He's the edge! The fucking edge, man! All right, Edge, don't touch him, Dad! He's the edge! You might cut yourself, he's the edge!" Doorbell rings again, the fucking dad goes down. Some fucking alien is standing at the door. "Who's that?" "That's Adam Clayton! Adam Clayton! Do-do-do-do! Adam Clayton! Do-do-do-do!" I'm fucked. This Bono's fit for a little fucker, isn't he? The doorbell rings for the fourth time. We all know who it is. The dad goes down, opens the door. "How are you, Larry? How are you, Mr. Houston?" "Is Norman around?" "Just kind of borrowed the lawnmower." "Who are those fucking agents? How are you? Don't want to be in your band. Would you ever fuck off? I'm already in a band. Fucking R10 boys band. Keeping the fucking rail. We've an interesting relationship with celebrity here. It's not the same. It's ordinary. It's just like, oh, there's your man. Doesn't this fucking you live another type of life bullshit that you get in other countries, you get in places like America? Whereas these celebrities are suffused with fucking stupidity and insincerity. Sharon Stone was fronting this campaign in Los Angeles called We All Have AIDS. That was an invite. And it was photographs of celebrities, famous fuckers who don't have AIDS. Besides skinny dying fuckers, who do? We all have AIDS. I'm a celebrity. You must care about all these people like I do. Would you ever fuck off? I don't have AIDS. I have hay fever. That's my burden, baby, and it's enough to be fucking dealing with. You get the impression that maybe Bono does actually care, though, don't you? The end of the next U2 show is incredible. The Edge gets his guitar at the end. Where the streets have no name. Where the fuck is that? Who would want to live there? Is it Tala? The Edge gets his guitar. He turns it into a rocket. It goes flying up into space. And it explodes a planet that U2 have rented off God. All these poor people fall out, and Bono catches them all. Edge, Edge, would you? Ah, fuck you. New York last summer, I experienced hot rain. Hot fucking rain. Why not just have soup falling from the sky? With croutons for the homeless. There you go. Told you I'd mind you. Hot rain. If we had hot rain in Ireland, people would be standing outside with huge fucking tea bags. God has put the kettle on. Tea for everybody. But now, we've stopped drinking tea and look what's happened to us. Huh? Everybody's drinking fucking coffee now and everyone's got a fucking job and plans and stuff to do. Back in the day, back in the fucking day, when we were all drinking tea, we got that same sense of job satisfaction that people get now from having high careers. We used to get that by doing simple shit, letting the fucking cat out, opening a window. Other countries, that was the only place we worked hard. Other fucking countries. Ireland was our little fucking secret. We'd work like anything in other countries. I remember one time being in Barcelona, working on a site for the Olympic Village, and we built what became the tallest hotel in Barcelona. Now, it wasn't supposed to be. They only ordered a bungalow, but we just got fucking carried away. Loads of other people started joining us. We had French fuckers, Germans, Portuguese, Italian, and Spanish. Crews from all over the world. And a Spanish guy slipped and fell to his death. We were the only crew that kept working. We just kept fucking going. The Spanish got thick and started throwing rocks up at us. Hey! Hey, malatos, patatos! Malatos, patatos, mañanos, malatos! Jesús es muertado, hey, malatos! We were there, hey, fucking relax, would you? You wouldn't throw us up a brick, would you? Then we saw that they were having a drink for the man. We put the fucking tools down. We'll never. We'll never see the like of him again, will we? This facility for darkness, well, it also enables us to live somewhat in the spirit world. You know, that's why bands loving performing in Ireland, because we're a great crowd. Because we just have that space in our bodies or something for magic, for stuff that's not logical. That's why we love going to Lourdes. Lourdes doesn't make any fucking sense whatsoever, but we love it. We love the idea of the bent, the busted, and the bedraggled of Europe. It's like the fucking canteen during Lord of the Rings. Making their way. And they stand in huge queues, and they wait for so long, and they're so excited. They believe the river will heal them. That was the river! 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 Someone gives them a pill. Cheers. They're so excited. And they get into the river, and they have visions of themselves unfurling and buying hats and cardigans. But they're standing there. Nothing. Fucking nothing! They step out of the river and they're thinking to themselves, for fuck's sake, that was shit. I've more diseases now than I had before I fucking went in. Someone take me to Disneyland, please. And I do have a lot of time for religion. I believe that every town should have a big fucking convent on the outskirts of it where holy nuns live. Because nuns are slightly magical people as well. They live in these big four walls and they pray all day. That's what their job is. They pray all day, sending love out via Bluetooth into the world. And they believe that this love makes a difference. They believe if they weren't fucking praying, the world would be in a worse condition. But the nuns are getting old, ladies. Huh? When are you gonna do your bit, you selfish fucking wagons? With your Renault fucking Clios and Mazda 303s. Join the nuns, you bitches! You fucking bitches! The little old nuns are getting old, so they are. And they do it in shift work, 3-hour shifts, all hours of the day and night, summer, spring, autumn, and winter. In the dead of winter, they're there, freezing! How do they keep an eye on each other? How do they make sure every nun is doing their bit? They watch the news. They're there every morning watching it. Newscaster comes on. Good morning. At 4:15 a.m. Irish time, a bomb exploded in downtown Baghdad, killing 17 people. And all the nuns just fucking stare at Sister Agnes. I only fell asleep for a little while. Well, you're very quick to criticise, that's all I'm saying. I'm 140. I kind of like the Pope, even though I know it was very tough to be the Pope, because the Pope is only a human being. The last one was a fucking goalkeeper. He's ordinary. The Pope is supposed to forgive you if you do anything, anything at all. It must be hard, though. It must be hard to be the link between the human and the divine, because you're only a person. I reckon when the Pope starts getting twitchy, when he starts getting a bit stressed out, there must be a special room in the Vatican that they can fucking bring him to. A special place. There's no windows. It's soundproof. Maybe there's a toothless Peruvian blind whore in it for him to knock a bit of crack out of. Maybe. But what happens in the room stays in the room. They close the door and the Pope just, I don't want to be a fucking Pope! You fucking wanky bollocks! You fucking fucking hoe! You fucking cunt! You wanky bollocks! I rape you! I rape the fucking head of you! He gets out of his system, puts on the fucking dress again, walks out, how are you? This big old crazy world. Are there any questions? Nobody knows entirely how we fucking got here. And what if one day we find out that there is no God? What do we do? Say, a ship reaches the end of space. It's empty. Send back a telegram to Earth. No sign of him. Think it's going to make that much of a difference? Do you think that we're going to stop looking after one another? I don't think so. Think nuns in Africa, when the news comes back, will suddenly throw the clean syringes into the dirt, turn to the villagers and say, fuck you, bunch of AIDS bastards. Sweating me a hole off in the fucking jungle for the last 30 years. Could have been running a bed and breakfast in Galway during the races. Well, don't just stand there fucking ride me, won't you, will you? Give me a bit of big black Mickey, for God's sake. Have mercy on an old lady. We're getting cleverer all the time. People are figuring this stuff out. You know, so, but I wonder about clever people and the way they forget how to do ordinary things. There was always this kid in your class in school when you were growing up who was brilliant at chess but couldn't ride a bicycle. Or some maths genius who couldn't tie his shoelaces. Stephen Hawking is like that. He is so fucking clever that he has forgotten how to walk. Because it's too easy. There's photographs of him walking when he was 19. Stephen Walking is what they used to call him. And they all say that in the beginning there was nothing. Right? Nothing. It was impossible for us to get our minds around that because there wasn't even nothing. There was less than nothing. In order for there to be nothing, you have to have something to compare it to. So there was no, there was anti, nothing, no. And this nothingness got so fucking intense that it exploded. And they call this the Big Bang. And Christians... What's that? Are they showing the hurling somewhere? Is that what it is? Okay, these men. It's two things. It's a bit late now. And secondly, these matches aren't decided by auction.
I got the Glen Gully!
Mead, fucking watch us. Do you think?
Use those comments.
And there's probably nothing in your life that fucking excites you as much as men hitting themselves with sticks. Go on, Loch Derg. Jesus. That'd be some fucking hurling team, wouldn't it? They wouldn't even wear boots. Hit me, fucking hit me!
Brown bread and water, fucking horse into me. Here we go, I'm fucking here.
But they'd only be able to run round to the pitch in circles. I'd be like this. Do you think there's drugs in the GAA? Yeah. I think there is drugs, but I don't think they're sophisticated cosmopolitan drugs. I think they're farming drugs. That's what I think they're. They're bovine steroids. So. And you notice it after a while because the players are fucking. It's an honour to play for me. Anyway. The Big Bang, okay? And Christians like to believe that behind this Big Bang there is a loving God. And maybe there is. And maybe, I think it's arrogant though to presume that a loving God made us in his image. So I don't think human beings are that central to the earth experience. There were billions and billions and billions of years of animals before we came along. When people arrived on the world, all the other creatures didn't suddenly jump up and shout, "Surprise! We've just been getting the place ready. We thought we'd start you all off in Africa. Right? Now the Irish can leave after a week because it's fucking roasting." If there is a loving God, then he loves not only us, but everything that is here. He loves crocodiles. He loves cobra. He loves cancer. And God fucking help me for saying it, but he probably fucking loves awfully too. And to think that a loving God made all the animals in the world. A loving God made Tyrannosaurus Rex. Do you think so? Up in heaven, in his animal workshop, putting creatures together. And when he designed this fella, he went, "Ho, ho, 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 I'm a bad motherfucker. Mammy, mammy, come and see what I've done. Look. Look at the head in the mammy. Look at the big, vicious head in the mammy. The size of a bus. A bus. I fucking must invent a bus. Look at his lizardy eyes, mammy. Look at his mountain range teeth. And I've made him angry. Roar! I made him angry by giving him tiny fucking arms. You'd be angry too if you couldn't pick up your kids. The only thing T-Rex was good for was playing the accordion at dinosaur weddings. But don't give him a drink when he's finished. And I'm glad Tyrannosaurus Rex is extinct because there is no place for him in the modern world. Can you imagine him driving round town in his smart car? Trying to reverse into the handicapped space.
Couldn't even play poker. I can't pick up my cards. I can't pick up my cards. I don't care, I'm all in. I'm fucking all in. Call me, I dare you. Roar! Dublin, thank you very much for listening and good night.